Obviously, the reason I turned professional was from a financial point of view. I think everybody has to secure themselves for life, and this was an opportunity for me to secure myself for life.
I decided that because rugby league in those days was don't touch me, you know. If you were a rugby league player in those days, you were barred from everything, you know. I mean, you weren't part of the social thing, not only rugby, but the social everything. People just sort of shunned you, you know. You were a professional player.
Moving it very fast. Here goes Watkins sliding over to Sidney Derrick. Watkins trying a drop goal. Getting a drop goal, I think. Yes, indeed.
It was very difficult. I mean, living in Club Row, it's very much a working class area. Your father was a miner, your grandfather was a miner, both grandfathers were miners, and you know. One of the great things about it, they weren't happy for us to go underground. They were trying to look for something better. Basically, it's my Welsh youth cap when I played for Wales as a youth and under 18s.
And my first experience was going to France, and that was just incredible. I'd never been abroad before, and here I was going to France to play in an international rugby match, albeit the youth team. We lost 36-0, but because the press wasn't quite as eager as it is today, I came back home and tried to convince everybody that it was just a 6-3 loss that we'd had, and it wasn't as bad as everybody thought it might have been. We were up back to home, and an old Mark 10 Jaguar, the old type Mark 10 Jaguars, came down Club Row. Everybody bar none was out on their doors, you know, thinking, gosh, who are these people? And it was three gentlemen from St. Helens Rugby League Club. If people knew that they were rugby league people, gosh, I mean, it ruined all your chances you thought of ever playing for Wales as a rugby player. Joe Pickervance, who was the secretary of St. Helens Rugby League Club, came into the room and my father was saying, oh, my boy's going to play for Wales one day. He'll be an international rugby player. And yeah. Joe Pickervance said, well, rugby league's a game. We'll move him to the north of England. We'll get him out of the confines of family life down here. Not only that, we are prepared to give him the open to this case. And inside was £5,000 money. And my father looked at it, looked at me, looked at the three gentlemen up north, said, where do we sign? We'll all come. And that was my father's. And my mother was saying, no, Jack, he's too young, he's too young, he's too young. He can't go away on his own. But my father had never seen so much or heard of so much money in all his life, you know, as a minor. Of course, I denied and wouldn't play, and then I had the opportunity to go down and play for Newport. I mean, it was the most exciting, it was the biggest game of all. To have 28,000 or whatever it was here on that particular day, you just wouldn't believe people. And it was something extra special, really, and an opportunity to play against players that the world knows. To come down here as we did on that Wednesday afternoon to play the All Blacks, and you go into the ground and you made sure you're over here early enough, and it was quite incredible actually seeing the people swarming in, even from work in afternoons who've taken time off to come, and it was just a mass of people, and you knew when you came out from running at the top end of the ground and running out onto the pitch here to play against the mighty All Blacks or something. Quite outstanding, something I never dreamed of, I suppose, as a youngster.
Crosser to Watkins. And here goes Watkins on the outside break. Back to Stuart Watkins. And here's danger for the All Blacks. Lahore covering for the All Blacks right in front of their posts. Now Newport want the heel. Can they get it? They can. Crosser. Hazel trying to drop goal.
That one drop goal that John Hazel did, and suddenly we all jumped in the air because it went over the post, and we were 3-0 up against the All Blacks.
I can honestly say, hand on heart, that I went to watch a lot of other games in Wales as well, hoping that they didn't win.
hoping that the side that they were playing, the Aberavens and the Swanses, didn't win, because we would then be the only side that beat the All Blacks.
Me at my house in Six Club Row, cleaning my boots for my very first international, so you can see how excited I am then. I always remember walking across to the ground, getting to the main gate at Cardiff, and he said, "Where's your ticket?" The gateman. I said, "Well, I'm playing this afternoon." To which he didn't believe me at all. And it took some convincing of people then and others for him to let me in. So I can imagine my very first cap for Wales and not turning up because the gateman wouldn't let me into the ground to play against at England at the Arms Park in Cardiff. But it was a momentous occasion, and then being presented with your cap as you did after the game, which is quite incredible. It was a prized possession to play for Wales and to be an international rugby player, being watched by nearly 60,000 people, was something you just couldn't have envisaged as a youngster, and here I was doing it. Campbell Lamerton was the tour captain. It was a massive job being captain of the Lions at that particular time, when you're on a five-month tour, as it was to New Zealand, Australia and Canada. The sad part about it was it brought him down, really, and became too much for him, and made it rather difficult for him. And one of the only good thing out of it, as far as I was concerned, was the fact that he dropped himself in the second test in New Zealand and made me captain. Because of the conditions and everything there, we had to go out on the runway, on the airport, to do our training. Somebody would shout, "The plane's coming," and all of a sudden, 30 players would be running off the pitch at the same time, in case the plane came down and hit us all over.
For leaving the Valleys and joining Salford Rugby League Club, David Watkins of Newport and Wales pocketed £13,000 tax-free.
I went up with Jane, who was my girlfriend at the time then, I've been my wife for over 40-odd years now, and we went up to Manchester and had the money, bought a house for cash, you know. Who would ever do that in those days, I suppose? Really.
We went out onto the field, 19,000 people at Salford, packed to the ground. Most of them had come to see me fail, the rugby league people in particular, and then to say, "Why on earth have you paid all this money for a 5 or 6 midget from South Wales, you know?" And to score the 70-yard try in my first game was the best thing that ever happened to me, quite frankly. They weren't all like that. I had many bad games from then on in. I always remember one game, and I missed, went into one tackle and got pushed off into another tackle, pushed off until suddenly one exasperated wag in the crowd said, "For goodness sake, Watkins, hit him with your bloody wallet." So biased was it at the time. I got hit after the ball had gone, you know. And I said, "For God's sake, Webb, you must have seen that happen." And he said, "Hey, don't ask me to look after you. Look after yourself. You've been paid enough." And that was significantly what everybody thought at that particular time. The money became the most important factor of your rugby career. Once you've gone north, you really put your cross on the door and burnt it. You were now a rugby league player. You were a professional. You were being paid for what you were doing. You'd gone to the north of England. You moved away and you did what you wanted to do. And that wasn't acceptable to the people down here in South Wales.
I could hear Dad. He would no doubt tell everybody who I was associating with.
You could come home and say to people, "Oh, I sat with George. We had a meal together, you know." A miner, which would be one of 200 or 300 that worked at the colliery, he was the guy that they would sit in the tea room asking him questions about Man United to Man City. Rugby gave you an opportunity to A, to meet people, B, to travel, which you couldn't have afforded to have travelled the extent of the travelling that I have done, and to have the good times I've had. To have a wife like Jane, who was bringing up 2 children while I was still enjoying myself playing rugby and going off on the tours, then you have to be very grateful for that. And we've been together for that right the way through it. And her family and my family have been so supportive. So at the end of the day, it's like everything else in life. If you don't have that support from all those people at the same time, it can make life pretty precarious to have a sporting career. So rugby has given me something that I've got to be so grateful for in life, quite frankly. There I was, a valley boy, a working class background, and having an opportunity of doing far more, and having the opportunity to do everything you wanted to do in your life. And when you sit back and think about it, it really does give you a sense of how lucky have I been. And I have been extremely lucky, I suppose, really.